From Corolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, Tiller Russell, with Gina Grad on news and Bald Brian on sound effects. And now, sex machine to one of the chicks, Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get on. Your mandate, you get it on now. Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Handball, Brian.
This bitch I'm fucking always tell me that she loved me, but she ain't ever showed me.
Hot mic.
Sorry, buddy.
More people than Dawson can hear you in that booth.
No. Tales of heartache and woe.
He never learns.
All right. So yesterday I start off the show by making fun of a CNN reporter who was on the site at the Tiger Woods crash for not really doing his job. And now, because I'm fair and balanced, I'll make fun of a Fox reporter. So I was watching Fox this morning and heard a story that Gina, of course, has in her news. So she may have more of this coming up. But Lady Gaga's dog walker shot multiple times.
Or was he?
Oh, boy.
Uh-oh.
Well, according to this story, shot multiple times and in critical condition. But it wasn't so much about the Lady Gaga story. It was sort of how they covered it because the dogs were involved. So I'll just play you what I got from Fox this morning.
Offering a massive cash reward after suspect shot her dog walker multiple times and made off with two of the singer's three dogs. Jonathan Hunt on the story in Los Angeles. Jonathan.
Hey, Harris, $500,000. That's the reward that Lady Gaga is offering for the return of her two missing French bulldogs. This after a bizarre scene last night in the West Hollywood area of LA, in which her longtime dog walker, 30-year-old Ryan Fisher, was apparently shot several times in the chest as he walked her dogs. Lady Gaga herself is in Rome right now. She's said to be distraught. Here you can see that's one of the puppies. That one is Gustavo, the white French bulldog. She also has a light brown one, Koji. He or she, I'm not sure, is also missing. That's Koji right there.
All right, well, let's pause it for a second. First off, you don't want to be a longtime dog walker. That should be a college gig, you know, part-time.
But making ends meet.
Little side hustle, but not a full-time, long-term dog walker.
However, this could be an MC Hammer situation where it's like you put your friends on the payroll.
Posse.
Well, we'll
right.
call you the dog walker.
Right.
Hammer time. So she, all right. So first beat is she's offering the reward for the dogs.
Mm-hmm.
At least
That was curious.
Is how he describes it.
Yeah, it's the headline.
I would be interested in the people that shot my longtime friend multiple times in terms of the reward, but she's putting it up for the dogs. But as we can see, this guy's not giving a lot of airtime to the guy who was shot. He's focusing more on the dogs and their names, but you can rewind it 10 seconds if you can. We'll just keep going. But it becomes sort of farcical at a certain point.
Bulldog. She also has a light brown one, Koji. He or she, I'm not sure, is also missing. That's Koji right there. And then there's Miss Asia, a black French bulldog. Now, Miss Asia, there you see her, apparently ran off during this attack and then was later seen on video, first being cradled by Ryan Fisher, the dog walker who got shot, and then in a particularly touching video was bundled up in a white blanket by a couple of police officers and carried away into their patrol car. But the bottom line here, two of them are still missing, Koji and Gustavo. Ryan Fisher himself,
my God,
if you come across any dogs, entry into the
police is in critical condition in the hospital. The robbery homicide detective unit now following up on this case, and Lady Gaga offering that $500,000 for the safe return of her missing French bulldogs.
Between the accent and the way he's saying it, it sounds like he's telling us there's only four Wonka tickets left.
I can't believe that the homicide detectives are not out on the street looking for the dogs.
I
can't believe they're following up on the guy who was shot.
So this dude's obviously alive because they said he was well enough to follow the dog and find it and cradle it. That's a resilient motherfucker.
First of all, much like the Jaws of Life with Tiger that was reported and everybody went with it and then it was corrected. It was first reported that he was shot multiple times. He was shot one time in the chest, which is probably why he's still alive.
Why don't we... I don't think they were saying, Brian, that he... retrieve the dog. I think they were saying two were taken, I guess, and one got away. One just ran away and then came back or something.
I heard him say the dog was later seen on video being cradled.
Right.
By
so,
dude.
It seemed like what I got from it is he got shot and he was laying on the ground and the dog came back and was sniffing him or something. But I don't know. Good. But again, I thought the computer and the digital age was going to fix all this. He shot multiple times. Why is getting shot once become multiple times? On the other hand,
perhaps there were multiple shots and someone heard it on a police scanner, but he only got tagged one time.
Well, there's surveillance now. Of course, TMZ has surveillance footage already of the dudes getting in and out of the car. And Caitlin or Chris, you can pull that up. It says warning graphic video. I haven't clicked on it yet. It's brand new. It just showed up just now, or at least I'm seeing it just now. So what they're saying is, and this could change because it always does. In fact, there's a Deadline article that came out that said the headline is something to the effect of Kobe's death has taught the media nothing about between Kobe's death and Tiger Woods' accident. Media has still learned nothing about how to report these things because, you know, we keep getting it wrong.
Right.
The facts keep getting released wrong and we're trying to figure it out. So I think two dudes got out of a car because French bulldogs, apparently there's like a black market for French bulldogs.
Why do you got to bring race into this, Gina? We get
it. Well, look, they're beloved French for Francophiles. It's golden retrievers, labs, German shepherds, and French bulldogs are like the top four most popular dogs in the U.S.
I believe you, Gina. I believe everything you're saying. However, is it the most likely scenario that they somehow knew that this dude was walking Lady Gaga's dogs?
Possibly, because then went on to say that you can sell a French bulldog from between $3,000 and $5,000. And if you can show pedigree, you know, lineage, it's $10,000. So between people just snatching dogs and people saying that's Lady Gaga's dog walker, I would assume this guy was targeted, but we don't know. So they shot him. Somebody heard one of the dudes say, give it up. And there was a struggle. The guy got shot in the chest, collapsed. Each guy grabbed a French bulldog and got back in the car.
Wow.
Now, I always kind of say this, like when we talk about the wives that poison their husbands to collect on the insurance and stuff. These
slowly
people like this are the scariest human beings our society has to offer, right? Just will shoot random person for random dog to make $3,100.
Yeah.
It's interesting if they knew it. They knew it was Lady Gaga's dogs, but that then, you know, this feels like one of those. Remember those like caper films where they would steal a car and then at the end they'd pop the trunk and it was filled with cocaine and now the drug kingpin was looking for them. Like these guys, these guys probably brought a little more heat on them than they may have wanted. Maybe they were just trying to make a quick $5,000 and now Lady Gaga's on them and it's all over TMZ. And
well, now they can make $500,000.
Yeah.
I know where the dogs are.
No questions asked.
That's going to be difficult to pull off.
How does that work? How does no questions asked work?
Because at least ask the bank account to wire the money.
The cops would probably have a few questions.
Yeah. So I heard he was shot multiple times, but he was shot once, but I guess he's stable now, critical. It was just funny to me that most of the story was about the dogs.
Yeah.
Lady Gaga, you know, I mean, she would have done herself a favor by saying $500,000 to find the people that stole the dog, because in that case, you'd find the people and you would get your dog. But she just kind of kept it on a narrow lane with the dogs. And who the hell knows what she said? You know what I mean? We just know what this guy said. And also, it does strike me that 20 years ago in this country, if we told this story about Cher's dog walker being shot, we wouldn't have given so much mic time to the dogs.
Correct.
Because 20 years ago, dogs were dogs and a human being was a human being. I think we've learned in this story that the actual dog may have passed human beings.
In this case scenario, far more valuable.
I've said it many times. Like if you say to most housewives now, there was a car accident and the mother and the daughter died in the car accident, the woman will go like, oh. And they also had a bulldog that died as well named Rascal.
No, it died.
Yes, that's how we're wired now. We do care more about dogs than human beings.
By the way, if we're just talking about it now, we can do it if you want. There, Kaylin does have the surveillance video queued up. It's obviously silent, so I mean, we could take a look at it and just sort of do a little play-by-play if you want.
Don't criminals know that whether you're stealing Lady Gaga's dog or punching somebody on the streets of Manhattan, there's a video everywhere now, right?
Always.
Especially in West Hollywood, you're not in the middle of a hiking trail.
Right.
All right. Let's see.
And by the way, I think Lady Gaga's in Italy shooting a Gucci movie. Does that sound right, Brian? I don't know if you know anything about it.
I couldn't tell you. Sorry.
She's shooting a movie about Gucci. All right, here we go.
So that's just at night.
There's the dog walker.
He's walking the dogs, just going right down the
main street.
Here comes
a car, almost cuts him off, stands right next to him.
Guys get out, wrestle around a little, go for the dog, I guess. Shoot him at some point. I'm surprised. This is West Hollywood?
Yeah, in a very residential neighborhood.
I'm surprised the meter maid didn't give the guy a ticket for parking in the lane
been there.
You can't
seconds.
Stop that.
Yeah, you guys, anyone's tried to park their car in West LA knows you get out and walk to the meter, you'll have a ticket on it. So I guess they shot him.
They grab the dogs, they're back in.
Yeah. And what's it really say about dogs that those dogs would be every bit as happy with their newfound criminal friends? Is that all? Honestly, if those guys had one sack of Trader Joe's jerky in the back of that car, that dog would be much more into them than they were to Lady Gaga or the dog walker.
Yeah, the loyalty is now shifted completely.
They're not your friend. So, let's just hear the story one more time, Dawson. Now we're queued up. We can hear how much he talks about the dogs. I won't interrupt this time.
Cash reward after suspect shot her dog walker multiple times and made off with two of the singer's three dogs. Jonathan Hunt on the story in Los Angeles. Jonathan.
Hey, Harris, $500,000. That's the reward that Lady Gaga is offering for the return of her two missing French bulldogs. This after a bizarre scene last night in the West Hollywood area of LA, in which her longtime dog walker, 30-year-old Ryan Fisher, was apparently shot several times in the chest as he walked her dogs. Lady Gaga herself is in Rome right now. She's said to be distraught. Here you can see that's one of the puppies. That one is Gustavo, the white French bulldog. She also has a light brown one, Koji. He or she is also missing. That's Koji right there. And then there's Miss Asia, a black French bulldog. Now, Miss Asia, there you see her, apparently ran off during this attack and then was later seen on video, first being cradled by Ryan Fisher, the dog walker who got shot, and then in a particularly touching video was bundled up in a white blanket by a couple of police officers and carried away into their patrol car. But the bottom line here, two of them are still missing, Koji and Gustavo. Ryan Fisher himself, by the way, the dog walker, we've just been told by police, is in critical condition in the hospital. The robbery homicide detective unit now following up on this case, and Lady Gaga offering that $500,000 for the safe return of her missing French bulldogs.
Paris? No. The bottom line, in summation, the bottom line are two of the dogs are missing. Footnote, the guy is in critical condition.
I also like that there was a touching moment with the cops cradling the dog in a blanket. Yes. Like I could hear the guy on the ground shot going, I'm going into shock. We only have the one blanket.
Who has the swaddle?
We got the one blanket.
We can call for backup.
It's going to take a while to get that second blanket here, but do that move where you breathe into your hands, where you cup them over your mouth. Because we do have the dog over here. I do like it was a moving scene where they cradled the dog in a blanket.
As the guy bleeds
tried
out.
Tried to soothe the dog. Jesus Christ, everybody. Now, I always tell everybody, I don't need to see data and statistics and eyewitness testimonials. I just hear stories like this and I go, oh, this is our society now.
Here's where we are.
Here's where we are. Because the here's where we are stuff is, it's not stuff that you plan and present. It's the kind of shit that just happens. You know, like he wasn't doing anything. He was just doing a story. And in his mind, the story was Lady Gaga's dogs were gone. That's the story. And lots of stupid, you should never, don't take a lot of pictures of your dogs in stupid hats, because at some point when they're snatched up by criminals, we're A, going to have to figure out what the dog looks like minus the Santa hat. Right. There's a lot of people that are watching that going, I'm looking for a, what is it? What kind of dog is it?
A French bulldog.
A French bulldog. And then they go, that one looks, he's not wearing a Santa hat, idiot.
This one didn't have a tutu.
Yeah. So all the pictures of the dogs seem to have something added to them, or hats or tutus or something like that. But
as long as we're talking about the footage, I'm glad we talked about it. Is there anything more amateur hour than the news has a 4-second clip of a dog swimming? So they play, how many times did that clip play back and forth?
19 times, 13 times.
Back, burp, 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 burp. It's like, all right, well, diversify.
Also, 81% of the dog's body is underwater in the clip because they're in a pool. Then the 14% that's above water, they're wearing bunny ears. So we can't. There's no way I could recognize that dog. There's not enough of it. I would definitely recognize the crazy chick who seems very jovial behind the dog, almost happy that the dog was abducted. They played it six times. And that's the other problem, too. There's the poor chick who gets caught. She gets fragged because she's like, we're having a good time. It's like, sweetheart, this is a very serious situation.
This is not the time.
I don't know why you're celebrating in that swimming pool. Right. So Lady Gaga's dogs are gone. The guy was shot multiple times, except for he was shot once. And it's also kind of nuts that you bring a gun, you know, that's loaded with the safety off. Basically, it's like, hey, we're just snatching a dog. There's two of us. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, is it really going to come down to that? We're not rolling over an armored car here. It's just some guy walking through West LA with a dog. We just run up and grab him, throw him in the car, push him down if he causes a fuss.
You'd think the general thinking, I would imagine, for criminals, the rule of thumb is if the person you're attacking could be armed, then you come loaded. What are the odds that Lady Gaga's dog walker in West Hollywood was packing heat?
Well, also, and you think, and again, we're trying to graft on, you know, you criminals are not pragmatic anymore. But
you didn't think this through, you criminals.
But the difference, all right, if you live in Los Angeles and you just jump out of a car, grab someone's bulldog, throw it in the back of the Camry and speed off, if we apprehend you, you'll never see the inside of a prison cell.
Right.
You'll get a slap on the wrist. Garcetti may even give you the keys to the city. I don't know. That's what LA feels like to me now. That you wouldn't.
Yeah.
With our
you're
new
dog napper,
our new DA and Garcetti, and you'll never. You might get a 300. I guarantee there's a stiffer fine for driving in the diamond lane alone than these guys would have got if they just grabbed the dog, threw it in the car, and took off.
Probably still fine for having your dog off leash than for getting trying to kidnap a dog.
Right. Now, when you bring a gun to the party, now there's going to be some extra time added on. And then when you shoot somebody in the chest, first off, you don't know
quickly.
You have no idea if the guy's going to die. Obviously, right. You just shot him point blank in the chest. And if he dies, then you go from slap on the wrist and a fine and some lightweight probation or something to in prison for the rest of your life because you couldn't figure out a way to get these two dogs away from this waify guy who was walking them down the street at night.
Story's not going to go over well in the yard.
No.
What are you in for?
What'd you do?
Yeah. You know Lady Gaga? Oh, my God.
Go on.
Showing us before the show that Tessa has got some new jewelry. And was showing it off in a funny sort of way.
She put a new ring on her, a plastic ring on her middle finger. He goes, "Look, Daddy."
gave you the middle finger.
Hold still. I got to take a picture of this.
But it made me think, and I don't, you know, it's interesting how we've morphed. So when I was growing up, my mom was a hippie and she had her hippie friends and there's always been kind of a hippie movement. The hippie movement is sort of given away to just a more mainstream kind of progressive thing. But a lot of the thoughts are the same, and thoughts that pertain to gender, they haven't changed that much, but they were modified. So like when I was a kid, it was nonstop talk about, well, you give the little girl plays with her dollies and the little boy plays with his pop gun. But if you gave the girl the pop gun and the boy the dollies, then they would equally be entertained. And we're just foisting our gender norms onto these kids. And you think about it and you go, maybe there's something there. But, I just lost Gene and Bald. But the second you have kids or you're around kids, you know that they just do that on their own. There's nothing about society that does that to them. Or if there is, it doesn't impact them nearly as much as the nature. We think it's nurture, but it's nature. And the argument that I used to make, and we'll see if we get them. Did they drop off?
The internet.
Oh, the internet. What's our internet thing around here? I feel like it's...
They suck. Like,
right?
Yeah, we only have one option here, and it goes down on the entire block all the time.
Who knows? Look, all right. I'll just keep talking, is my point. And we'll do some trending topics, too. We didn't really get to yesterday. The best experiment is to have twins, boy and a girl, and then you'll see exactly how the boys and the girls roll and how goddamn different they are. And it's not surprising to me that young Tessa loves jewelry. And if Brian had a young Timmy, then he would probably love trucks and army men and all that. But my argument is always this. I used to say this on Loveline all the time when they'd go, well, this is society. This is society, like, foisting its norms on the kids. This is a, you know, and they'd go, how come the men build the bridges and the women are nurses and school teachers? Why are we doing that to people? And I always say this. How do you think it got that way? You think there was some book we were going off of 2 million years ago? I mean, why is it? Okay, I'll ask you. Why are more women school teachers and more guys structural engineers? Because that's the way society made them. It's like, who made society? How did we get here? This is not some old rich white guy with a cigar that goes, I decree this and I decree that. There's a fucking reason, you idiots, why women are attracted to certain things and men are attracted to other things that nobody started. It's just society. We didn't have rules when we started. That's the way it started. The guys went out and hunted and the women stayed behind and did the cooking or took care of the kids. And then you want to know why? I don't know. Look in any other animal kingdom and figure out why orangutans, the male orangutans, do. And by the way, do we ever question it in the animal world? No, we never do that. They happily tell us, you know, the mother polar bear, the female polar bears, they do the hunting. Yeah, that's what they do. Who forced the polar bears to do that? It's insane that we question so much of what is. And now the whole gender thing is this. My mom's probably the happiest woman on earth because we went well beyond her initial ideas about they give the little boy the truck and the little girl the dolly. And now we can't even say what you are. We don't even know what you are. You're nothing. You decide. The parents aren't even going to tell you whether you're a boy or a girl anymore. Which is going to, I don't know, solve how many problems? What solves more problems? Getting the guy who voices Dr. Hibbert on The Simpsons, getting a black actor to voice that, or us deciding kids have to get to decide their own gender? That's a real problem solver. Woo! Trouble over, kids. There'll be no more Lady Gaga dog snatched on the street because... we've solved the problems that vex society, which is, we'll just let them. We're not going to decide for them. By the way, I got news for you, man. When you have kids, they just fucking do what they do. They just fucking do what they do. And good luck shaping them. Who talks more about playing Pop Warner football for 7 years and what a crazy impact it's made on my life and how it was a lifesaver and a game changer for me and how important that is. This podcaster, whose son has never played 10 seconds of fucking football? This podcaster. Do you think I would have liked my son to play Pop Warner football and get all the blessings and the diligence and the discipline and all the stuff that I got from it? Yes. Could I get him to do it? No. You want to know why? He didn't want to do it. That's it. I mean, there's little stupid stuff like brush your teeth. Fine. But you really think you're going to push your son toward dollies if he's not into it? I saw this so early on when we were at the Feast of San Gennaro a million years ago. And the way we parked the car was like up against a block wall or something, and we couldn't get in through one side, so we had to get in the other. And it was just one of these things, and the kids were like 2, 3 maybe. And it was just like, Sonny, you got to sit in Natalia's pink car seat until we get home. We live 2 miles away. You know, just you guys swap seats. You sit in that seat, you sit in that, whatever. Sonny pitched a fucking fit. It was like a stuck pig because he had to sit in the pink princess seat. It's not because he was coached up, because that courses through his veins. All right. Back. I think the guys are back.
And we're here.
Yeah. So, Tessa, are you, again, when you have kids, you just realize they just go. They just do what they want. They're interested in what they're interested in. I mean.
Right. Because.
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. I was going to say the toys, I don't know if you remember this, Adam or Gina, maybe you came on the scene too late for your little one, but the toys for like infants, right? For like babies, like 1-year-olds or whatever, like those are gender neutral. They're
right.
Just, they're whatever.
Animals.
They're stacking blocks or whatever, animals. And then they just kind of, at least in my experience, my extensive experience with kids, Tessa just kind of gravitated towards what she likes. And now it's fucking all Disney princesses. It's all, like, for example, she loves Star Wars too. Like, she likes just stuff that she likes. I may have, you know, encouraged her for the Star Wars stuff. But a good example is she imitates Christy and wants to do whatever she does because she's the mommy, and you know she sees her putting on makeup, and now Tessa like tries to put on Christy's makeup, and she sees her putting on her jewelry, and she would try to put on Christy's like rings, which have a certain value to them. So we're like, well, Tessa, let's get you your own rings. We got her a little set of, I don't know, 16 rings, and she loves them. So the earrings, she asked for earrings or clip-on guys. She loves playing dress up, and not just that she's following Christy because she's the parent. Like, she sees me shave my head every couple days. She's never once expressed interest in shaving her head or shave. You know what I mean? It's not just like, oh, I see the parents doing this, I'm going to imitate it. No, she's gravitating towards, you know, what Christy does.
Yeah, it's the same over here. And like, you know, we've talked about this so many times with Adam. You know, it's funny because you have your very own test subject in your house. You have one boy, one girl, the exact same age. And with the little boy here, it's all Super Mario Brothers. It's all dinosaurs. It's all, will you play with me? What do you want to play? I want to play fight. That's all we do. All I do is flip him around. You know, he wants to fight. He wants the focus pads. He wants boxing. He wants Hot Wheels. And is it boring to me? It certainly is, but it's what he's into. And, you know, he liked Rey, you know, when she came out for Star Wars and stuff. But otherwise, and look, we don't even talk about this stuff ever. And I'll say like, oh, look at this one. And it's a girl. He goes, I don't want that one. It's a girl. It's for girls.
I'll go one step further. Agree with Gina and say that Tessa always wants to do like some sort of role-playing game. Like, let's play Star Wars. Let's play whatever. And then she'll start assigning us roles. She goes, Daddy, you're the bad guys. Mm-hmm. And I'm all the good girls. Like, she wants to be Princess Leia or whoever, Elsa and Anna from Frozen. Like, she wants to play role play with being the heroines.
Brian comes in and goes, I am Contrarior from the Point Shitting Gallery. And I've come here. nothing wrong with
that. Elsa doesn't sound like that, young lady.
Nothing wrong with the roles, you know? Nothing wrong with the male and the female role. It kind of works out nicely in nature, I would argue. And there's definitely an application.
And, yes. And if your kid, if your kid bucks those norms just naturally, good on ya. More power to ya. It's all
just
the
like,
same. But in our
like
house,
our kids, it's like how they are.
Right. In our house, this is just what he's all about. And I do have a news story that will possibly make your head explode about this in the news.
All right. Well, we got started with trending topics yesterday, but we didn't really get into them. So we'll take a, let's see, do I got a piece of work here? No, we'll take a quick break. We'll come back with the trending topics right after this.
And now, a tip from the 1965 issue of Good Housekeeping. 120 ways to please a man.
Certain foods just can't miss with men, and one of these sure things is a steak. See to it that he has a good sharp knife to do his slicing and plenty of elbow room. After you prepare the food ahead of time, your only pre-dinner duty is to discreetly disappear.
Just one of 120 ways to please a man. Now back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Your job is to disappear.
Discreetly.
Discreetly.
You walk out backwards.
Yeah. Don't make too big of a thing about it.
Don't make it all about you.
Well, look, in 1965 is a long time ago, but I was technically born a year before. Did couples not eat at the same time? Or what is this?
Sometimes,
how does this work?
Sometimes daddy just needs to wind down on his own.
Hmm. All right, so she just make the steak and discreetly scamper off.
Like the servant.
Yeah, all right. Do we have an intro or we'll pick it up from where we left off yesterday.
All right, so a couple other things that have been trending recently. I'll start it off with those Muppet warnings on Disney+.
Why did we get interrupted yesterday?
Brian, please.
I forget.
What are you doing?
So the Disney Plus, we were talking about the warnings for all the Muppet shows. Well, they might have something to it because in 1957, Jim Henson was approached by a Washington, D.C. coffee company.
57?
Yeah.
Wow.
A Washington, D.C. coffee company to produce commercials for a thing called Wilkins Coffee. and they had these 10-second spots that he made, and they've been making the rounds on the internet. Millions of people have been watching this week, and we'll play some of them for you. So these ads, they star a character named Wilkins, who loves the coffee, and Grumpy Wonkins, who hated it. And there's a lot of violence in these commercials, and everyone's just kind of like, whoa, these were actual commercials that featured Muppets in the 50s. Obviously, so people are saying, well, we couldn't do this today and things like that. He made 179 commercials.
Do you know, Chris, where these 10-second blurbs would air?
Yeah, so it was all local. So this is a local coffee company in Washington, D.C. So it's all local.
Oh, sure.
Okay. Yeah, and...
like, we pause enough for station identification.
That's exactly what it was. So 8 seconds for the commercial pitch, 2 seconds shot of the product, and we move on. But these things were a hit. So Cam will play some of them for you. And they're fun. Here's a few of them.
Why are we climbing this tree?
For Wilkins Coffee.
I don't want any.
It's autumn, and the nuts are beginning to fall.
Just punts, wow. Wonkins.
Punts the guy.
Good. I like it.
It's my favorite.
On guard, fencing. Salute They're Wilkins fencing. Coffee.
But I don't drink Wilkins Coffee.
Oh, some no. learn, some don't.
Just wipes the blood off his sword.
Oh, he wiped the blood off.
Wow.
That is dark.
How about a delicious cup of Wilkins monument. Coffee?
No.
Strange things happen to people who don't drink Wilkins.
That's very Kermit-y, right?
The Washington Monument falls on him?
Yeah.
I love it.
Oh, this is Kalen's
favorite.
I've
got five aces. Poker. Can you beat that?
I've got a can of Wilkins coffee. Nothing beats Wilkins.
Jesus!
Shut
up!
Wow.
Hey, so he just randomly shoots Wonkins.
Not $65 for a cup of Wilkins coffee?
Sounds like Kermit.
$65?
You want me to go in there looking like a bum?
Yeah, it's a vaudevillian joke.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I think this is the last one.
Do you have
one.
Any Wilkins coffee in your house?
No.
There's a bomb
in
the house.
You know, a house isn't a home without Wilkins coffee.
Jesus blew him up.
Yeah, so these commercials were a hit, all right? They became syndicated and reshot for different companies. So he made over 300 ads using these characters. And with it, they saw a 300% increase in sales for the coffee. And they
sold. Retention getting, especially for 1957.
Yeah. So just a reminder, the Muppets were created in 55.
Oh.
So, yeah, so these Before are actually this. Considered Muppets. I mean, yeah, Kermit, there was an early Kermit back then.
That sounded like Kermit.
Yeah.
And Rolf.
Yeah, you could see.
Yeah, like, Kermit and Rolf.
He was trying to get his footing, so I guess.
Yeah, but speaking.
The poker one is amazing.
Speaking of shaping your kids, like, do you think you could have got Jim Henson to work at your unfinished furniture factory? When he was 17, you know what I mean? Like, come on, it's the family business. Now we'll put you and you'll be in shipping. You know what I mean? Like, would that ever work on that guy with that mind? You know, that guy was probably in his parents' basement making things and doing the voices and doing the, he was doing that when he was 9, right?
If he was an unfinished furniture warehouse, they'd ask why all the end tables are now marionettes.
Yes. I'm actually going out to dinner tonight with John Popper from Blues Traveler. And I guarantee
nothing.
That guy was sitting around with a harmonica or beating on pots and pans when he was 5. You know, it's just in you or it's not. But it also kind of makes me wonder, like, you know, when you talk to people and they're like 42 years old and they're like, I'm not sure where my gifts lie. And I'm always kind of like, maybe you don't have gifts. I mean, don't you think something would have bubbled to the surface by midlife? Some passion of yours? I'm sorry.
It presented itself.
Yeah. What else you got, Max Pan?
All right. Well, this next one, this one's pretty fun. And it could be a good question you ask John Popper tonight.
Mm.
So Mike Gillette, he's an author, and he just put it out to Twitter. Okay, Twitter, what's the best music venue in America?
Mm.
Thing is, what was?
It can't be converted. A converted sports park venue. He's talking about a place that was built for music. And then he says, I nominate the Greek Theater in LA.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Because you know what I was going to say, what I imagine is the most popular? Red Rocks.
I was going to say that because I know Blues Traveler's played Red Rocks a bunch of times. And if you ever get a chance to go there in person, it is dramatic. It is, you know, I've always said this, like, don't walk up on the old Batmobile. You will be very unimpressed. Like, there's certain stuff you walk up on. It's kind of like, Mila Kunis or something, where you walk up on her. If you see her in sweatpants and in flip-flops, yeah, you'll be like, that's cute, I guess. I mean, she's not what I thought, you know, like.
Can't believe it.
You show, I have done that at the Family Guy. The point is nothing against her, just not awe-inspiring. No, I mean, if you only see her from movies, you'll think of her as this amazing beauty. If you see her in real life, she's kind of small, just pretty eyes, but it's not
right.
It's not a traffic stopper. But
the Hollywood sign's a good example of that.
Yes. You go to
great from far, but
you go to Red Rock, and it's like, oh yeah, this is dramatic.
Yeah,
like it's beautiful.
We went there not too long ago, Adam, and we went hiking, and we couldn't go to the theater because Lettuce was playing that night. So
that's
they close it, the jam band Lettuce. So there were a lot of Lettuce tailgaters. And yeah, and I remember you and Sonny were walking around Red Rocks, and that was a good time. We saw some snakes.
Yeah, we stepped over a snake. Yeah, we got a nice picture with Baby Driver. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, look at little.
It's also insane when there's some band you've never heard of, and they're selling out Red Rocks. I didn't even know Lettuce was a jam band, I guess.
Yeah, couldn't tell you.
Well, Alyssa Milano chimed in on her favorite one. By the way, Gina, Red Rocks was the top answer from everybody.
I'm not surprised.
Alyssa Milano, she loves the Troubadour.
You've
ever been there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she chimed in.
Many
to the Troubadour. I remember in 2016, Adam Dawson and myself, we went to see the Jayhawks at the Fonda.
Yeah, that's a nice
great theater. And Adam taught me a good trick that I still used, and I carried on to every show after that, because they have these plastic, you get your cocktails in plastic cups. And everybody's on the floor with their cups. And then after the song, how do you clap? What are you doing? You're just going to pat your chest. You can't clap both hands because you have a drink. So Adam put it in his mouth and would bite it, hold it in his mouth, and then was able to clap that way. First time I've seen that, and I've been doing it ever since.
Well, when I went for the two-fingered whistle, the thing came flying out of my mouth.
Right.
So you got to keep it clapping.
You got to pick one. And also, Adam, I know you've gone to a lot of shows. I was just curious on what your best live musical experience is, other than Fish with Mike Lynch.
Ugh.
I mean, you've been to a lot of festivals. You've hosted a lot of them. Do you ever, like, just watch the bands and are just blown away?
The best, the thing about going to Fish is when you sit next to a guy who's seen Fish 385 times like Lynch, all he does is explain to you, oh, last time they did all of Quadrophenia. I'm like, well, this time the guy's been laying down a bass lick for 40 minutes. I don't know what the fuck it is. Oh, they did Sgt. Pepper's the time before. Yeah. Well, now the guy's on a solo bongo run for 25 minutes. Well, last time John Mayer and John Popper came out and they all did Dark Side of the Moon. Right. But I don't know what song is playing right now. And this song has been going on for 42 minutes. So I don't want to hear about last time.
Yeah, this you're actually like, making it worse.
And by the way, you'd be a horrible pimp. Like, I know she's giving you a hand job with a piece of sandpaper. Last time, she blew the bejesus out of this Japanese businessman. I mean, she sucked that guy off. But good, more emery cloth? Yeah.
That was awesome.
I don't. This is up there. I don't need the last time. And I don't need the fucking waiter. Remember the waiter who'd come out and go, the specials. And then they go, and we have the Asabuco. And you go, oh. I'll go with the Asabuco. Yeah, I'll have the Asabuco. Yeah. And then they go back. Then they come back 9 minutes later. Yeah, we're out of the Asabuco. I'm going to taste it in my mouth. I'll have the avocado toast. So, yes. What the fuck? Oh, live. Well, I'm just going to say I went, as long as we're on blues and Blues Traveler and the House of Blues, I went to the Sunset House of Blues and brought out Blues Traveler and just stood in the wings and watched him. They're such a fucking great live band. And my real recollection of that evening is it's always fun to see the bands before they go out on stage because they're just like sitting in the green room, like smoking a joint or drinking a beer or something. That anything but talk about whatever it is they're going to be doing in 5 minutes. But the great Ron Jeremy was backstage and it was weird that there was a a time in this nation's history where Ron Jeremy was kind of a star amongst the rock people and amongst some of the people. He was kind of there's a weird pecking or pecker order of like who's a celebrity and like who's not a celebrity. But Ron Jeremy was like featured in songs and like showing up places and, you know, in the green room with John Popper and Blues Traveler, Ron Jeremy was kind of the celebrity of that group.
Wow.
Yeah.
I have a weird Blues Traveler story, too. It was the Cinco de Mangaria that we did a few years ago. They played. John Popper, sick as a dog, and he comes on. He could, like, the guy could barely stand. He's like, I'm still going to play. I just need a nap. And so we just leave.
Spraying his sickness everywhere via his harmonica.
So we
atomizing
leave him,
it.
We leave him alone in the green room. He just curls up in a blanket on the couch. And then when he goes to play, you can't even tell. And I remember they were phenomenal. And I remember during that event, Adam was interviewing Howie Mandel for the podcast. And I was doing the audio for it. And in the next room, before Blues Traveler goes on, you hear the harmonica going. And Howie's like, oh my God, listen to that. And Adam's like, yep, that's John Popper playing the harmonica, warming up. And Howie couldn't believe it. And then after the podcast, they get up and they got to go see John Popper warming up. He opens the door. It's Ron Jeremy in the corner with John Popper's harmonica just blowing into it. That's what they were hearing the entire time. Wow.
I told you he's a bigger celebrity than John Popper.
Fucking guy can do it all.
Cyrano.
I remember that moment. I pointed at him, at Ron Jeremy, and I said, you got it.
Yeah.
I predict great things for your future.
So, Chris, are you saying without saying that every time John Popper goes on stage and pretends to play the harmonica, Ron Jeremy's back there behind the curtain with a little microphone up to him?
Situation.
Exactly.
I'm just there's a conspiracy going and I'm behind it.
Okay, I get it.
All right, speaking of music, though, guys, Adam, you are obviously all about the kids getting back into school.
Yeah, man.
Well, Washington State, this picture has been going around yesterday. Wenatchee High School Band. They're back in school, and they are playing. They're doing band practice. It all looks fine, except they're all in tents. Like they're all, and by in tents,
oh, in
I mean they are actual
tents.
In tents.
That's crazy.
Tessa has one of those.
Yeah, so we
what
have one in the
those?
Front
it's
yard.
Like a little stand
those little
up
pop-up
tent.
Tents. Yeah, they're a pop. They fold to like the size of a large disc
for one person.
Yes.
What does one?
Or two kids.
Well, pre-COVID, what were these things for?
Yeah, I don't.
I know what the application is like. Look,
kid?
I want to go camping, but I don't want to sleep. But I don't like.
I want to stay standing.
Here are my rules for camping. I hate mosquitoes, but I also don't want to sleep. So if there's some sort of tent that could accommodate my hatred of mosquitoes and my love of staying awake, I would appreciate that. Yeah, what? I don't know what the tent. There's a guy with the tuba.
Yeah, that's the sousaphone.
No, that's me.
Oh, that's a sousaphone?
But no, yes, I mean, tuba. Like, yeah, poor tuba players, poor trombone players. Like, what are they going to do in these things? They can't fit in those. These are personal-sized tents.
And I hope they disinfect the shit out of it for the next group.
Yeah.
But these look, they're back in school.
All right.
In-person learning.
These are stand-up tents.
That's crazy.
Yeah, we're kind of, you remember in Naked Gun where they had the love scene with the full-body condom.
The full-body condom.
Yep. We're kind of getting there, right?
That's it. That's what
that's
we just witnessed.
That's it. So the whole band was in there. And I still got to figure out what those tents, those tents could have been created before COVID, but pre-COVID.
Yeah, what would another application be?
A kid's plaything is the only thing I know that to be used for, like a little fort or something. Tessa has a Toy Story version of that.
Huh.
Yeah.
All right.
It folds up to like size of a large disc.
All right. Well, I'll just name a few.
Sorry. Breaking news. I'm looking at my pod one-person pop-up tent, and because it had that big screen in front, it looks like and for what application, I'm not sure, but you're supposed to sit in a chair in it. So I don't know if that does anything for you.
Here's
is that for rain?
I'm going to say you want to go see your grandson play flag football. There's a lot of mosquitoes in the neighborhood. You just sit in there, and or it's drizzling outside. I wonder how many of those weird oxygen bubble helmets we see advertised at LAX. Do you think they've moved a few of those units?
I've not seen a single one.
Me either.
I've not seen one either. Good. All right, what else?
All right, well, I'm going to name a few companies here. J. Crew, Neiman Marcus, Chuck E. Cheese.
Problematic.
Brooks Brothers.
It's all problematic.
CPK, California Pizza Kitchen. Sizzler, Guitar Center. All filed for bankruptcy during the pandemic.
Oh.
But it looks like these ones look like they'll probably get bailed out, but... I mean, we lost Sioux Plantation, which I'm still bummed about.
Oh, devastating. Oh,
can I, let me, at the risk of outing myself, I think I've already explained that I enjoy the Hawaiian-style pizza, and I take a lot of flack for that with guys like Kimmel and other pizza experts. But the California Pizza Kitchen with the barbecue.
Oh,
The barbecue chicken. Yeah. I fucking
so
love
good.
That pizza.
Yeah, with the red onion.
Cilantro.
Is that okay?
Yep.
I think I miss pizza more than anything on the Vinny NSNG plan, because you can do a burger with a lettuce bun and it's more or less the same. There's versions of everything. Pizza is the hardest to like, I mean, aside from sweets, donuts or something.
Brian, unless you're incredibly lactose intolerant, I have to introduce you to Andy's Pizza Diaz.
Oh, with the cheese.
It's just cheese and sauce.
I was saying this the other day. Is there a decent cauliflower crust pizza that's on the market?
Yeah.
Like a frozen one that you could get that was good?
There's decent ones at Trader Joe's, but they're good for cauliflower crust pizzas. They're not good for pizza.
There's a big texture difference.
You have to temper your expectations because it's much softer. You won't get anything that resembles anything doughy or anything crispy.
I had a good almond flour one.
Could we, and then what are the, I was getting a pizza for me and Sonny the other day, and I was looking at their, what is it? Not the keto, but the low, it's the same as keto.
Gluten-free?
Yeah, the gluten-free. Yeah. Are those any good?
Not the same at all. That's
those are awesome. The gluten, well, it depends if you like anything that's kind of like a thin cracker crust, because all the gluten-free pizzas are generally like rice flour and tapioca flour, and they're crispy. I think they're better.
Could we do this?
I like cracker crust.
Would you guys be with me on this? We've essentially created a sort of second moon launch or race to space to replace meat. You know, we have all the synthetic
Beyond
whatever.
Burgers.
There's work and everyone's working. Right now, there's 1,000 people in 1,000 countries all working at simulating a steak. Mm-hmm. Could we work at simulating some fucking pizza dough?
Yes.
I mean, could you just get a keto pizza dough that had the texture, that was a little bit chewy? Seems easier than steak.
Yes.
Yeah, the only thing, well, it's funny because remember heme or hemi or whatever, that's the blood that mm-hmm. they synthesized for the Beyond Burger. The thing that makes pizza doughy is gluten. Gluten's a binder. That's the whole point of gluten. It stretches, it's bindy, it's stretchy. That's what makes the dough stretchy. So that's what they got to figure out. Like, gluten seems like this intangible just name, but it's literally the thing that makes bread stretchy. So that's what we got to figure out.
I need that stretch. It's got to be a little bit tough. Just a little bit. You have to pull on it a little bit to get the bite off it. Yes, that's the difference between all the other stuff, the keto stuff and the real deal. Although, if you go thin crust, it'll be less. And I've always argued a better pie. Okay. All right, one more or two more or whatever you got.
Oh, well, continuing with the ones that went bankrupt now, but I was just going to say that this one is actually the number one trending topic yesterday, Fry's Electronics. They closed down.
Yeah.
So they, after nearly
all
36
overnight.
Years. Yeah,
shocking.
All overnight.
31 locations, stealthy, gone.
But shocking they were still around?
Yeah.
Sort of.
Wouldn't you say it's kind of where Radio Shack left off?
Yeah, but Radio Shack left off 15 years ago. That was
right,
that's my point.
But this isn't exactly like a Best Buy. It's something different. Like, it's less. Yeah.
They were all themed differently. Like here in Burbank, we had, it was a spaceship.
Spaceship.
Yeah, all space themed. They have Aztec temples. And a lot of people are just saying, Look, they've been making bad decisions for years with these themed, with these awful themes. We could see it going out of business.
The one in Arizona is like an Aztec or Mayan temple or something.
You know, we'll never have anymore, which they used to have sort of, and they have it at the Fry's out here in Burbank, I think, and they would have it like army surplus stores. The creepy use of the mannequin. Like mannequins, they're fine when used properly, but they're sort of like clowns. Once they go creepy, they get weird fast. And when you do the one and it's just naked and they put the Prussian helmet on it or something, it's it gets really weird. And I, the Fry's out here had that.
Yeah.
On the other hand, there is something nice about walking into a place and having some nerd guy there and go, I need a thing, but with the kind of adapter for the, then they know what you're talking about and they can lead you and guide you.
It's the promise of the Apple store, right?
Yeah. Obviously all the online stores.
Genius bar that can do whatever, you know, this problem, they can usually fix it.
Yeah.
Geek Squad.
Now, what do you replace, like when you're the Fry's? The one that's in Burbank is 60,000 square feet. Yeah. I mean, it's a big space. So do you just become a warehouse or like what kind
Amazon
of store?
Distribution center.
Yeah. Because you can't just be a furniture store anymore, right? Or a mattress store, right?
Do you know what everything in the valley becomes once the lease is up and you have more square footage than you know what to do it? You sit tight until about September and they become those massive Halloween warehouse stores.
You can go seasonal.
Yeah, like Riverside and Coldwater.
No, I think it's about growing pot. But you know what happened? You know where the real moment was that we didn't really anticipate in this country, if you really think about the difference between like sort of the old generation and the new generation, and it marked the beginning of the end for all of the Fry's and all the clothing outlets or mattress stores, all these big places we'd go to in another era. Where we jumped the shark, and, you know, I don't like talking about cars on this program, but...
Oh, come on.
Okay, I'll come out
just
of my
please,
car.
Just one. Just
all right.
Make an exception.
You take... So, I've been interested in cars and buying cars and into cars for quite some time. And in the past, if you were going to buy a race car or a street car or any car, you'd see it up on eBay or someplace like that. And they'd go, where is it? And they'd go, it's in Virginia or it's in Dade County, Florida or something like that. And it'd be like, ugh. And then you yourself, or you'd have to pay someone, you got to fly out to Virginia and I'll put you up overnight. Then you go inspect the car. And then you come back, we get a good report, then we'll buy it. Bring a Trailer, that website, routinely sells cars for over $1 million that no one ever sees in person. It's just 10,000 digital pictures and a long, you know, description. You have to earn your reputation. I mean, you have
to
sell. Right. But there were no way anyone would buy a sofa without sitting on it back in the day. And you wouldn't buy a TV set without going and turning it on and looking at it. You would never buy a car without going to the car and like getting in it and turning
that
everything on. And you have to go for a test drive. People buy cars. People buy TV sets. People buy mattresses and sofas.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
No one wants to go look at the thing.
Yeah.
It's a pain in the ass.
So we took this thing where as Americans, if you went back 20 years ago and you said, would you ever buy a TV set, a sofa, a washing machine,
mattress,
a car, a mattress? Would you ever do that without physically going to the place and like kicking the tires, you know?
Are you crazy?
Everyone would go like, no fucking way. I'm not going to do that. I got to see that car. I got to be there. You know, I got to touch it. And that was how we thought. And that was it. And so if you owned a car dealership or a sofa emporium or a mattress emporium, you'd go, well, I'm good. But we never anticipated the part where people would just go online and just go, fuck it, I'll buy it. And with every generation,
My kids don't need to see shit. They just go on to Amazon, see a picture of whatever it is, and you just buy it.
Yeah, works for me.
Well, and taking it up a notch, which you guys probably aren't as aware of because it's mostly for women, it's crazy. I would never have thought you can't buy makeup or you can't buy hair dye or you certainly can't buy makeup without going and opening the tester, putting it on, just testing it. Now you take a picture of your face on most of these sites and they will put the color on your lips. Mm-hmm. So literally there is no reason to leave the house.
Yeah, like there are glasses companies where if you're buying glasses, it puts the glasses on your like digitally on your face. Like, okay, these look good on me.
Yeah, it's you. It's your face.
Till later on that night when you catch a glimpse of yourself in the mirror and they're still there. That's where we're heading, folks.
Next season on Black Mirror.
Yes. So this notion that we will buy anything online and not only, look, if old man Corolla will do it, my kids are off and running. They probably would be insulted if you asked them to go to the store and look at whatever it is. You'll buy any appliance, you'll buy anything that goes in your house. And again, automobiles, which would have been unfucking thinkable. I mean, like I said, I'd buy an old race car and you'd have to fly the guy out to wherever the stupid car was just to physically like look at it. And maybe it's all high def digital photos and maybe it's people giving reviews and ratings and stuff like that. But, you know, something like Bring a Trailer, it started off kind of small because it was like, well, who's going to buy a car just by looking at pictures, especially if it's $75,000 or something? Well, the answer is everyone now. Everyone. There's no reason. And I don't know. Where are we going? We're going to have like online dentistry, like gynecology? Yes. Like where are we at?
We are at online dentistry because with a lot of these braces sites, you can just mail order them and they'll send you your trays and you can print them out if you have a 3D printer. Mm. Gynecology, I have put the camera right up to... No, I'm just kidding.
God, you had me. All right, let's wrap it up because Tiller's in the waiting room.
All right, you got stamps?
Yeah, I got stamps. All right, stamps.com, tips... Oh, I should say trips to the post office. Probably not what you want to spend your time doing. Stamps.com. Mail and ship anytime, anywhere, right from your computer. I've used it here. We've used it here for over 11 years. You can send merch, and we send out merch and books and paperwork and everything at Stamps.com. Whether you're a small business sending invoices, online seller shipping products, or a giant warehouse shipping thousands of packages, Stamps.com lets you buy and print U.S. postage for any letter, any package, up to 40% off postage rates, post office rates, and up to 62% off UPS shipping rates. Special offer, 4-week trial, plus free postage and the digital scale. No long-term commitment. Just go to stamps.com. Click on the microphone. Top of the homepage. Type in stamps.com. Our old friend Tiller Russell is joining us, and we'll talk to him right after this.
In the spirit of Murrow, Jennings, Cronkite, here's another great moment in local news.
I'm with KHOU, just wondering, what is it like seeing this right now?
Jeez, you tell me.
That's a great moment in local news. Now, back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Tiller Russell is back on the show. This time, we're talking about his movie Silk Road, available now on digital and video and on demand, written and directed by Tiller. Congratulations. I saw the trailer. I did not see the movie. The trailer was very compelling, and the story is kind of insane. So welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much for having me, my man.
And let's talk about some of the... It's based on a true story.
Based on a true story, the insane kind of true story of this young millennial gangster who unleashes what they call the Amazon for drugs. So anyone, anywhere, at any time can get anything they want.
And I know there was a story, I think, in Rolling Stone about this at some point. Where do you come into this story?
Well, I was obsessed with this story from like the very first day this guy got busted. Ross Ulbricht was this like 26-year-old millennial upstart who had created this website, and he ends up getting busted in the sci-fi section of the Glen Park Library in San Francisco. And I was off shooting some crime documentary at the time, but I remember opening the paper and thinking like, man, there is a movie. Like, who is this guy? What is this story? Because it was the first time we'd ever heard of, you know, Bitcoin, dark web, you know, sort of black market. And I have sort of obsessively tracked it until there was this Rolling Stone article written by this brilliant guy named David Kushner that went and kind of explored the origin story of this guy. He was a kid from Austin, Texas. He was an Eagle Scout. He was getting a physics degree. And how was it that he went from there to becoming this sort of unlikely kingpin at 26 years old?
Well, what's interesting, Adam, is we were just talking about Bring a Trailer and how no one would buy, you know, a car sight unseen, so to speak, but they were, you know, through ratings and there's a trust infrastructure sort of built in. A lot of crossover the Silk Road, because obviously you're never going to know anybody. They're all using aliases. You're never going to meet that person. But through a series of elaborate system of ratings and just a trust infrastructure, people know that's okay to send their money to this anonymous person and you're going to get something in return.
It's like eBay or Amazon, right? I mean, it's this weird thing, but suddenly it's like you're buying dope online, and then unbeknownst to him, the mailman is your drug dealer.
I've always kind of said it, think about it, out and back when society was open, you'd walk out of a Clippers game in the Staples Center and there's a guy with a modified shopping cart and a propane tank, and he's selling you and your kids hot dogs. And you go, where the fuck does this come from? And where's your license? And is this clean or whatever it is? But the point is his product can't give people botulism. He's out of business. You know what I mean? Like, even that guy, he doesn't need a regulatory body or health inspectors or anything. It's like he's got to. I'm sure you'd rather eat at a restaurant that had, a rating number out front of it. But I'm saying is that guy's product has to be consistent. Otherwise, he's going out of business, even if he's not like officially in business. And I would say that's a universal truth, whether you're selling hot dogs, drugs or cars.
Well, and the weird thing is, if you think about it, and he says this, you know, Nick Robinson, who plays Ross Ulbricht in the movie, says this at a certain point, like, once upon a time, before there were weed stores and whatever else, when you're going to buy a dime bag or a quarter bag or whatever it is, it's not like you have any notion of whether it's like bunk or any good or whatever. In a weird way, you're much more likely to get a better product if there's like users and ratings, and it's like eBay.
I will say this. You said he was an Eagle Scout. Eagle Scout, it's feast or famine. Either you're an astronaut or you become a drug dealer, and we use it ironically. You know, he was an Eagle Scout and he killed his family.
It breaks one way or another with the Eagle Scout.
Yes, you're either top of the world or you're incarcerated now. I would think very carefully if my son wanted to be an Eagle Scout, because this could be a lot of pride, or we could have to fucking disown you.
Long-term branding.
That's right. Sorry,
just
Gina.
To your point, no, just to your point about doing all this stuff in the mail, it's so funny that you bring up, you know, weed and the ratings and all that stuff, because guess how you had to do it in 2000 in the late 90s in New York? You had to get in a town car that somebody drove up to your house in Queens and get in and drive around the block with a stranger and then be given a Ziploc bag, or so I've been told. So talk about terrifying. This is ironically the safe way to get your drugs.
I mean, that was the argument, right? And then, and because he has this exact argument with his girlfriend in the movie, and his point is like, hey, you know what you're getting.
Yep.
And how does, I keep, to me, I'm going to be laying on my deathbed and someone's going to say to me, do you know what Bitcoin is? And I'm going to go, no, I don't know. I can't figure out Bitcoin. Can you tell us how Bitcoin works or what it is? I mean, I know I'm just an old car guy, so but
no, tell us. I wish I had the like super simple explanation, but the truth of the matter is it's a like abstraction to me too. But the genius of what this guy did, for better or for worse, is he took two things. There was this thing on the internet called Tor, which basically makes everybody anonymous. And then he used Bitcoin, which is a cryptocurrency. So instead of having to, you know, send money in the mail or be dependent upon some sort of unregulated transaction system, you're able to blend both of those things, and it's one-click shopping. And it was the combination of Tor and Bitcoin that made Silk Road this worldwide, global, you know, black market.
And how much money did he make? Do they know?
Well, there's literally, you know, this, it's interesting. There's a couple of things. There was, you know, tens and $20 million. But the valuation of Bitcoin, you know, the amount of Bitcoin that he was arrested with at the time. Now, you know, Bitcoin's at all, you know, almost all time highs, 50,000 or whatever. It's hundreds of millions of dollars now. And then there's an interesting little news piece, which has come out recently. There was a bunch of missing Bitcoins and potentially hundreds of millions of dollars still out there in the ether somewhere, directly associated with this case. So there's some ongoing mystery to it. So
it's even alluded to in the movie. One character goes to cash out some Bitcoin, and it's far less than he anticipated. And the answer is just, hey, man, Bitcoin is very volatile.
And it is.
That's kind of interesting in that he was using Bitcoin instead of cash, but the Bitcoin ended up being the real value versus what he did. It's kind of like, I guess, whenever you talk to people about McDonald's, they go, it's not the 39-cent cheeseburgers, it's the real estate. They have all this real estate. And you go,
that's
is it?
No, sorry, in the McDonald's movie. The
Oh, right, right. Sorry, we're shifting movies.
You're right, sorry about that.
So, Taylor.
Well, you know, the crazy thing too, Adam, in this story is, but for this, you know, but for Silk Road, this marketplace, none of us would have ever heard of Bitcoin. This is what put Bitcoin into the zeitgeist. This kid gets busted in the library. It becomes this massive international story. And that's why to this day, Elon Musk suddenly is accepting Bitcoin, you know, as payment in Tesla. But for this story, none of us would ever have heard of Bitcoin, much less invested in it.
Where is the whereabouts of Ross? Is he incarcerated now?
It's a crazy story, actually. He ended up locked in prison and ended up getting two life sentences plus 40 years without the possibility of parole, which just by point of comparison is significantly harsher than the sentence that El Chapo got.
Yeah, why is that?
You know, some of it is he was offered a deal early on. He didn't take the deal. He fought the case. But I think in a weird way, there's something like this bookends the drug war. Like suddenly when the mailman is your dope dealer and doesn't know it and anybody anywhere can click a button and get whatever they want, the way the drug war was being waged once upon a time, suddenly like the U.S. government, the feds, the DEA, everybody got caught flat footed because the game had changed and it had changed overnight. So in a way, I think there was a let's make an example and throw the book at this guy.
Exactly.
I always think about guys like this, and I think, you know, we talked about guys who earlier we're talking about the guys who shot Lady Gaga's dog walker and stole her dogs, and I'm like, I don't need those guys. But this guy, like working on some projects. Like, I would like this guy's fertile mind trying. I bet if we took this guy and said, we're putting you on parole just long enough to solve traffic and the homeless situation in L.A. I bet it would improve significantly in 4 months.
Yeah, it's like Catch Me If You Can. Like, right. Let Leonardo's character come back and work with you with forged checks.
Well, and that's something like with this guy, it would be very interesting to see, you know, this, like he's 36 years old right now, staring down the barrel of this. And yet this is somebody that's already maybe for the dark side, but changed the world. What happens if you give this guy another shot and say, okay, put your mind, instead of being the evil genius, now be the mastermind and fix some shit that's not working. You know, suddenly that's, and I'm a believer in the second chance. Lord knows I've screwed up enough in my life that like, and been granted enough second chances that I'm a believer.
I agree. I don't want to rain on the parade here, but Ross, okay, I don't want to spoil anything either, but it's also just part of the public record. Ross, like attempted to have more than one person killed, right? Like, this is not just wire fraud. Like, it's attempted
Brian,
murder.
Who among us hasn't?
Oh, he did.
No, it's true. It's a complicated moral thing, right? Because on the one hand, like if you had some loved one and they, bought drugs on Silk Road and died, then you're like, give me this guy's head and like, throw away the key. So I get that on the one hand. And on the other hand, there are all, it's a complicated thing. And I guess at the end of the day, that's why I made the movie is I like these stories that are about people that have the forces of light and the forces of dark, warring against each other inside of them. It makes for compelling drama.
So for you, we know you from doing the docs. You want to do more features or more docs, or are you fluid about it, or what's your upcoming project?
I think I'd love to do them both because there's something really fun. These crazy true stories. I used to work in writers' rooms and stuff and it's like the true stories that I've done. If you walked into a writer's room and you pitched these stories, you would be fired because they're like absolutely ludicrous. But because they're real, it's fascinating. So I think I'll always go back and forth between the two. The next one I'm working on is Operation Odessa. I don't know if you've seen that one, Adam, but it's these three gangsters. Mm-hmm. Russian strip club owner, a Miami playboy, and a Cuban spy who sell a submarine to the Cali cartel for $20 million. So we're turning that documentary into a movie next.
Well,
that's great.
It makes it's fun for the viewer because as somebody who made the 24-Hour War, which is Ford v. Ferrari, the Matt Damon, Christian Bale movie, it's very satisfying to watch the theatrical version of it, probably in this order, and then go back and look at the doc and see the actual people and how the things they got right and the things that they took a little dramatic license with. But it's really satisfying seeing the doc version of the theatrical or vice versa.
And audiences are audiences love these, right now they're watching these crazy true stories, these crazy docs, whether it's, whatever you like, they're coming to them in a way and watching them in a way that we've never seen before. And then it is interesting to see, how do you translate it? What things did you get right? Where did you take liberties? It's a fascinating thing, I think, for audiences.
But do what Tiller did and make them both yourself, because when you make the doc, and the movie was 1,000 times more successful than the doc, then they think you made the doc after they made the movie. Or they're particularly, I don't know, it's kind of funny. People have no, I feel like people, they're not calibrated correctly. Like I'll go, Ford v. Ferrari, that big movie? Like, yeah, I made the doc about that 2 years early. And they go, there you go.
All right.
Pass the Spumoni. It's like, all right. I feel like you should get hey, that's a good idea.
Oh.
Yeah. Did those guys consult with you on it, Adam, when they were making it? Did they go to you and sort of pick your brain on it?
No, they did not. I would assume they watched a doc because it'd be a easy cliff notes on their story. And the story was, a lot of dramatic license in there, obviously, but they're making a movie. But no, we made the movie and we never, I suspect they don't talk to you for legal reasons. I think if they sit down and talk to you, then at some point you can sue them. It's sort of like we're talking about with spec scripts,
intellectual property.
Right. So I'll go ahead and assume it's that or, Matt Damon.
But I bet audiences, a big movie like Ford versus Ferrari comes out and then audiences are doubling back and like, dude, I want to see the doc. In a weird way, I do think it all, like over time, it sort of shakes out where these things cross market each other.
Oh, well, it's definitely helps you sell stuff to Netflix because 10 minutes ago before Ford v. Ferrari, they're like, we're not interested. And then that movie and they go, oh, you have the Carroll Shelby. We had made a Carroll Shelby doc too, with like the same, right about the same time. So then they ended up buying all those docs. Yes, Brian.
I'm so thrilled, Tiller, to hear that you're making the movie version of Operation Odessa. When you were on last time, I don't remember if it was when you were on the show or just before you would come on, I was singing the praises of Operation Odessa, the documentary, which is one of my favorite documentaries. Truly, I love it. And It is up there maybe in the top two or three things that I've recommended to this audience that has gotten universal love and praise and, you know, thanks. Like, oh my God, it was so fun, so enjoyable, so amazing. So I'm really thrilled. Are you going to call it Operation Odessa?
Operation Odessa, the movie. And the fun thing about the script, hopefully without spoiling anything, is like making that thing was just this insane odyssey. It began with me smuggling myself into a Panamanian prison to go meet this Russian gangster. And like, it only got weirder from there. And so some of that stuff is folded into the screenplay too. So hopefully it's a fun ride when it's done. But thank you for saying that.
Yeah. I know how tough it is in this town to have someone sort of hand over the reins, you know, like you direct and you write, you know, because everyone is sort of guilty until proven innocent. Like they'll do a lot of, we like the story, but we need to go with an established director and established something. How was the process for you of sort of getting through that? Once you get some good projects in your rearview mirror, then you become the established person, but it's hard to get the experience without the experience.
It's really hard. And like, once upon a time, you know, everyone thought it was schizophrenic. They're like, wait a minute, are you a doc guy? Or are you are you writing for television? Are you making movies? And now I think as audiences are more agnostic to it and sort of don't care, then they're more willing to sort of take the ride. You know what I like, and it's funny that we're talking about the docs versus feature versions of stuff. But now what I'd really like to do is, as these stories are getting made, it's be developing them both simultaneously. You know, in a perfect world, it's Silk Road, the movie comes out, and Lionsgate's releasing it, and then you've got the doc series that's also on Netflix at the same time, so audiences can really toggle between the two. So, you know, if that opportunity ever comes up, I'd love to do it and would like to try to do them simultaneously in the future.
Do you have TV stuff you're working on as well?
Yeah, we're actually looking at hoping to adapt Night Stalker as a limited narrative series, do the 8 to 10 part version of that. Wow. You know, with a great cast. So we're going in and pitching a version of that soon. So hopefully get to, now it's funny, now I'm like running back and forth on the bridge between the docs and the narrative versions of these. So hopefully I will get a chance to do both of those too.
It's a good thing that human beings are capable of absorbing so many hours of entertainment every day. Like, I didn't know, you know, when TV came out, they probably thought, hey, everyone's going to max out in an hour, maybe an hour, 10 minutes a day, you know.
Who wants to watch that much TV?
Right. We have an unlimited capacity to view stuff that people create, which is good for the creators. It's probably bad for the waistline of America, but it's good for guys like Tiller. And they'll watch it on their phone and they'll watch it. There's so much good stuff out there now. Like, it is so insane. I was watching, maybe you can find, somebody showed me the trailer for Dirty Mary, Crazy Larry today. When I was with Dr. Drew, 1974 movie. It was a feature. It was the feature films that would be in the theaters were nothing. They were just like, oh, that guy's got a car and he speeds off and the sheriff chases him and they fire a shotgun.
Bobby and Rose.
Peter Fonda, Susan George, Vic Morrow. A younger Vic Morrow before the whole chopper incident, if you guys remember that from Twilight Zone. That was insane. Yeah. That's the same Vic Morrow. And it's just like nothing. There was no skill. There was no plot. There was no story. If you get, I'll do 30 seconds of the trailer just so you can see like where, how goddamn crude everything was. And then the only good part of it now is, I will take my son and I'll show him the trailer and I'll go, that's what we had to watch. That's what we had. And then I'll show him a tattered penthouse and go, this is what we beat off to. This is all we had. This is all.
The good old days. This is the bad old days.
This is all we had. You got it, Max Spana? Sir.
Dirty Mary, Crazy Larry.
So far, checks out. You gotta keep on moving.
No time to tarry. You'll be
Peter Fonda,
bored stiff by the trailer.
Our Dirty Mary and Crazy
This
Larry.
Is in the theater in North Hollywood.
There is nothing they won't try. Larry can drive
almost anything. That's just a whole bunch of, like, drove a car, jumped it 4 feet. Average. The way he moves his old machine drives so merry wild. Larry's what you call your crazy man. No chance he won't take. I drove through two trucks. As for Dirty Mary, ain't no kind of love and she won't make. Hey, Chris.
Everything under control?
Yeah. We're enjoying this song.
Yeah. It's,
the title track is a winner.
It's the best part of the movie.
Yeah. So that was that. Now we have everything. Everything is on. And then it's great, but now you have to compete for all these eyeballs with so much.
Well, it's so exhausting. You get to the point where you're like, you go to throw on, like, what am I going to watch tonight? And then after like 30 minutes of clicking through, well, maybe I could also watch this. Then you're so exhausted. You're ready for bed after all.
Yeah. And it's funny. Like, you obviously you have everyone with their recommendations. At some point, look, forget about all your cool new stuff that Netflix is offering. I haven't seen The Wire yet. And people have been trying to get me to watch The Wire for 41 years. I was actually getting pitched 40 years ago. There's going to be a show called The Wire. You should see it. You're going to love it. It's the best show on TV.
I'm already pre-outraged. You're not watching this.
That's right. So where are you, Taylor? Are you in Los Angeles?
I fled the Southland for the moment. I'm in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and I have to say it's a little bit nice to be out of the fray for a hot minute.
Is the, like I have told my audience before, I famously drove Bryan Cranston to the Burbank Airport because he was filming Breaking Bad in New Mexico years ago. Is there a burgeoning, bustling production going on in Santa Fe?
Yeah, there is. And everybody got their sea legs actually working Breaking Bad. The guy that was my location scout for Silk Road, you know, was a location manager on Breaking Bad. And so, and Netflix is just building a huge new studio, wanting to make it a huge sort of central hub of production because there's great tax incentives, right? You get 20 cents back on the dollar or whatever. So there's a boom. You know, Paul Greengrass's last movie was in New Mexico. We shot a lot of Silk Road in New Mexico. It's, you know, there's a lot of action going on.
Oh, when I remember talking to Seth MacFarlane some years ago, and he was filming Thousand Ways to Die in the West or something. What he remember yeah. when Seth yep. did a Western, but mm-hmm. he was
Sarah Silverman was in it.
He was in New Mexico. I mean, that's 100 Ways to Die in the West. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a kooky movie. Kind of funny.
A million ways.
But the point is it's kind of interesting that all these places, like I grew up in Los Angeles, New Mexico may as well just been Mexico. Like nobody right. wanted to go to New Mexico. There's nothing in New Mexico. It would seem weird to go to New Mexico. And, we've kind of figured out my new yardstick is if it has a PF Chang's, I can live there. And I don't know if New Mexico has a PF Chang's yet, but they are moments away from getting a PF Chang's. Because
you may be able to drop anchor once the PF Chang's arrive.
Well, that just it's not so much. I do love PF Chang's, but it's more of a yardstick,
mile marker
to go, okay, there is a civilization here.
They have one in Albuquerque.
There you go. So yep. So it's like all the infrastructure's probably popped up around there too. I've never even been to New Mexico. Is it a livable place now?
It's, yeah, well, it's the, I mean, the cottage industry of the movie business, you know, ends up inherently, they just sort of spins off so many jobs that are associated with it. And I'll tell you what, like in the middle of the pandemic, you know, having a place that, what, you know, takes 5 minutes to get anywhere, you know, it's nice to be out of the madness for a minute.
Well, and Santa Fe, particularly from what I understand, is so, it's almost like Laguna, you know, it's the artistic community. It's like Topanga, but in New Mexico. So I hear it's a really awesome place to be anyway.
Topanga to Santa Fe. That was my tour.
Yeah, there you go.
Do you, I suffer from this a little bit when you hear ideas or you see the news or you read a story and you go, oh, I want to do that. Like, I want to do that story. I want to tell that story. We got to figure that one out. Like, and then at some point you get a little ADD about it and you get a little distracted and you probably realize you need to focus and do the one story and not be pulled in all these different directions like a kid in a candy shop. So how's that process for you?
Well, it's really weird because, you know, for one reason or another at this point, like people find me. So, you know, somebody will be like, yo, man, I just robbed 25 banks. You want to do a documentary? So like my phone is like blowing up with these weird calls or emails or texts or whatever. And my instinct is like, you always kind of have to take the call, respond to the email or the text because some amazing new story may walk in the door. And so I always one way or another do respond to it. But it is a thing where at a certain point you have to like, okay, I'm going to put down all the other possibilities and I'm going to lock in and do just one.
Well, Tiller, we're happy that you're having so much success and we're honored that you're willing to come on the show as often as you do. And I just love a guy who loves to tell a story. And I think ultimately that's kind of what we figured out about you. It doesn't really matter what the modality is, whether it's a doc or a miniseries or TV or Netflix or the big screen or features, you want to tell the story. So
totally good, Yoner.
We need those, and glad you're one of them. Silk Road is the movie. It's available now on digital and video on demand and directed by Tiller Russell. Tiller, come back anytime you like and talk about anything you want.
Thank you so much. It's great to see you guys. Be good. Stay safe.
Thanks. Tiller Russell. All right. We'll take a quick break. Come right back with the news after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. Weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gino Grad. Stuff they saw on TMZ. Joe Biden. Kamala. Meet news with Gino Grad.
News with Gina Grad.
Well, something that has just come out in the last hour or so as we record this, a former U.S. Olympics gymnastics coach with ties to disgraced sports doctor Larry Nassar has died by suicide after being charged with 24 crimes, including forms of human trafficking. The announcement from the Michigan Attorney General came about 3 hours after a news conference where it was announced that John Gettert was charged with these crimes, including sexual assault, human trafficking, running a criminal enterprise. The charges were the latest fallout from the sexual abuse scandal involving Nassar. He was the former Michigan State University sports doctor who's now in prison. So this guy said, we'll just take the easy way out instead.
Always surprised more people don't kill themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems... It's funny. It comes so easily to like depressed 14-year-olds in the Midwest, but yet you would assume. I'm always curious. I'm always thinking that the Bill Cosbys of the world or the Weinsteins are like. I'm like, oh, they're gonna kill themselves before they go to prison. I mean, they got to go from this life to a fucking cell. It's like they never do.
I think the true cliche here is that, like, in order to be that monster, that, you know, criminal, there's a level of narcissism. Like, Bernie Madoff didn't ever, you know, went to prison and, you know, maintained whatever. It's like, the fucking dude should have killed himself out of principle.
Jeffrey Epstein didn't kill himself.
Yeah, right. Well, Bernie Madoff's the ultimate example. His son killed himself for him. Like, yeah. I will kill me on your behalf.
Right.
I'm so ashamed of you.
Yes, I'll kill me. Yes, but the supreme narcissist does not do that. As a matter of fact, it's always kind of the opposite. They're outraged that they're in prison or that anyone talked about their deeds or whatever that is. So, yeah, you're right.
Well, and pivoting a little bit, this is pretty breaking as well. An intelligence report.
Gaga's dog walker not shot at all. Is that the breaking news?
They were at the groomer.
Oh, God.
The Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman gave the green light to the 2018 murder of journalist Jamal Khashoggi. But this is now like what we're all on the same page. He'll be will be released by the Biden administration. So based mostly on the work by the CIA, the intelligence report isn't new, but its public release is significant. It reverses Trump's policy of backing away from placing the blame on the Saudis for the killing, which was condemned globally. So far, the person who called for Khashoggi's killing literally got away with murder, but not now. Not as far as waiting till Jen Psaki has something to say about it.
I always bring. Is she a natural redhead? Can't figure out what's going on with that hair.
She's very pale.
I always say this about the Saudis, man. They were. I don't know how much of 9/11 was Saudi, but evidently a lot of 9/11 was Saudi. And we've known about it for a long time, and we're not doing anything about it. And it's been around for a while. And
20 years.
They're trying to, families, survivors and stuff are like trying to sue the Saudis, but we're not really playing ball with our own citizens in the Saudis. Well, maybe now.
And what is that? I mean, what kind of symbolic lawsuit are we talking about here? How would that work? They're going to show up on People's Court with Judge Wapner, the Saudi crown prince?
I have no idea how anything works. I just know, the basic, I guess, and I don't know a ton about Middle East and diplomacy and all that kind of stuff, but what you want to be is a sort of horrible, murderous regime surrounded by horrible, murderous regimes, you know, and then we go, yeah, they are the kind of the sane one in the group. So
by default,
yeah, we'll kind of back them and make sure they're taken care of. Because I just feel like that neck of the woods is so volatile and so fucked up that we have to kind of support, we have to kind of support people we should never support.
We just talked about the documentary, had the director on, the dissident. And like there was a part in there, just news footage, of Trump's literally holding up graphs showing how much they spend in our country, with the clear implication being, I'm not going to fuck with these guys. Our economy's dependent on them to a certain extent.
Yeah. Is it all oil money that they made? And if so, can we get away from that?
I was going to say, don't we not really depend on them for oil anymore?
I don't think it's the oil. I think it's other goods now, but the fuck do I know?
Well, the oil money that they have, now they're spending saying, like real estate and
that's
stuff?
That's what I'm saying.
We were oil positive for a while. I don't know, with the Keystone and kind of stuff like that. But we were exporting for a little while. We got to the point where we were making it. And then actually sending it, we were exporting oil for the first time in a long time. But I don't know if we're getting out of that now because of the pipeline and some other things like that. But all right, all I know is I'm going to Oklahoma City, and somebody sent me a picture of a gas station, and it was like $2.21 or something, and it's like
it's going to blow your mind.
But if I say about California, why does everything have to be the most here? What is that? Why
we're comically taxed?
I guess. it was like, I don't know, $2.19 a gallon, and it's almost $4 out here. Sorry, go ahead.
Yep.
Oh, by the way, Brickdown Comedy Club tonight and tomorrow. We'll do live pods there, and Kyle Dunnigan's going to be there. We'll do stand up as well. Sorry, go ahead.
Sacha Baron Cohen is done with Borat. He tells Entertainment Tonight that he's retiring the character and ending the Borat movie franchise. Well, why? It's so successful. People love it. He says it has gotten too dangerous. He says there were a couple of times I had to put on a bulletproof vest to go and shoot a scene. And you don't want to do that too many times in your life. I was pretty lucky to get out this time.
Who put him in those positions?
Yeah, right. So no, I'm not doing it again. I'm going to stay with the scripted stuff. He's starting Borat in 2006 and 2020. And he says, yeah, I don't want to do it again. I got away with it. I'm not pushing my luck.
What was the other one? Ali G?
Ali,
Bruno.
No, Bruno and...
Wasn't it what? Ali G?
Yeah, Ali G was one of his characters.
Yeah, but that, he didn't do a movie about it.
I know, I'm just saying. No. Okay, I'm just bringing up another character, though.
Well, and
I like that guy.
Well, and it's... Which one?
Ali G.
Oh, okay. I don't know if we're talking about Sasha or Ali. But that's the thing. Like, are we more volatile as people who are being pranked, or is he getting more volatile and agitating people more? What's the difference between doing Borat 15 years ago and doing it now?
I can tell you from doing hidden camera stuff, first off, you never know if you're going to get punched. You know, like there's a lot of like, you just walk up to the guy in the hardware store and you tell him his son's a pussy, you know, and then it's a big laugh, but it's some, you can get punched or shot or something. And there, but I'll tell you probably what it is. I think maybe when you're a 13-year-old boy, you really have the fuck with gene strong. That runs strong in every 13-year-old boy. Like, I'm going to go fuck with this guy. Like, I'm going to scare him. You know, it's a lot of hiding and scaring and pranking. There's just a lot of, like, fucking with people. And it probably happens that it's kind of like, it's sort of right up there with fighting. It's like you get a little older, the testosterone production slows down a little, the prostate enlarges a little bit, and you kind of lose your taste for like getting up and fucking with people. Like, because it's a real energy burner, like goofing on them and fucking with them and stuff like that. Believe me, I do crank yankers. If over the phone is hard enough, you do it. We used to do man show bits where you'd like hidden camera, go in there and fuck with this person. And it was always like, ugh. You felt kind of bad for the person, but you also kind of wondered if they were going to smack you or start crying or something. It's just kind of a young man's game, the fuck with people. Right. And, and it's just something you can kind of graduate from.
And I absolutely believe you. And I think that that has to be part of it. But if he's talking about, you know, I have to wear a bulletproof vest, like, that's, to me, he's implying the people he's fucking with are getting more volatile. Like, you think of him.
Yeah, but he's not going to say, I'm tired, I'm not doing Borat anymore.
No, you're right. But like, you, like when, you know, the famous scene from the first Borat of everyone singing Throw the Jew Down the Well, which was just the best. And then you go to the 2021 where he gets on stage in a costume and he's singing and they're kind of starting to notice that it's fake or that it, and then they you know, run after him and he has to pull the door shut in a Winnebago and he's kind of starting to freak out. And so it's like, it seems like it might be a little both.
Well, you also have to sort of outdo your last stunt.
Yeah.
So you got to go bigger and then bigger's more bold and more dangerous and whatever. So I'm sure it's a combination of everything, but I can tell you from someone who used to fuck around with people a lot, like just the simple act of scaring somebody.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That was something that you would do. You know what I mean? You'd go fuck with someone, go scare them, go hide and jump out or whatever.
Oh, it's like, best part of your day.
Yeah. It's just, you get a
little older.
Move
the needle anymore. That makes sense. So I don't know if you, Adam, are you a Post Malone fan?
I appreciate his work on the Doritos commercials.
Oh, good. Okay. Are you a old school Hootie and the Blowfish fan?
I appreciate the country version.
Okay.
Yes. All those Hootie hits are maybe have become a little tool-toony, but they're very enjoyable.
Oh, absolutely. And they're great.
That's the definition. Songs. Yeah.
Right.
Darius Rucker. So Post Malone has gone back to help Pokemon celebrate its 25th anniversary. He's done a cover of Only Want to Be With You from Hootie and the Blowfish. The song will be part of Post Malone's appearance at this Pokemon anniversary concert, which will be streamed on Saturday at 7 Eastern. I'm going to play you a clip. Mm-hmm. And I got to tell you, I don't hate it. Here's a snippet of Post Malone's version of Only Want to Be With You.
You and me, we come from different worlds. You like to laugh at me when I look at other girls.
But this is one of those things where I think the only thing you like about it is the song that you like better, right?
It has like a little bit of synth in it that like didn't bother me. Yeah. But it's, I mean, yeah, they stuck pretty close to the script.
Right. And then we go, oh, yeah, I like that song. And then you like this version too.
Yeah. Just go Hold My Hand or Let Her Cry, but it'll do.
Hold My Hands. Ooh, which one's the best out of those three? Only Want to Be With You, Hold My Hand, or Let Her Cry?
Only Want to Be With You is a distant third. The other two are fighting it out for
number one.
Yeah.
Let Her Cry is good.
Let Her Cry is, I think Let Her Cry is number one for me.
God, there was a radio station. I'm in Blues Brother mode. No, sorry, Blues Traveler. Blues Traveler mode. But there was a radio station out here for about 10 minutes. Maybe Dawson remembers. It was got popular in like 92, maybe 93. And for the first time, they were playing Sheryl Crow and Blues Traveler and like the Spin Doctors and Victoria Williams and probably Hootie, although Hootie went on to cross over and get really poppy. But it was an interesting time in the mid-ish early 90s when the Sheryl Crows and the Blues Travelers, that was sort of new. They didn't really have music like that. Didn't land in a category of punk or pop or contemporary or something like that. I'm trying to think what that station was. But I used to listen to all these guys on there. Like I said, they play Victoria Williams, so you guys should all get the album Loose, by the way, if you'd like. And Hootie and the Blowfish, Cracked Rear View is named after a lyric in a John Hyatt song, which is called Learning How to Love You. And he says in Learning How to Love You, the John Hyatt song, there was a life that I was living in this cracked rear view where no future was given to a hard and true or something like that. And I think Hootie and the Blowfish were big into John Hyatt. So I think they took, I think the story for their album of Cracked Review is from that Hyatt song. At least that's what I heard. And, and they would play the Jayhawks and bands like that. Yeah. It's like stuff you'd never hear anywhere. But I'm trying to think of what that station was. And, of course, it's got to be, you know, all Armenian all the time. It's got to be Spanish or Armenian now.
No, it's like Korean.
Could be Korean.
System of a Down, wall to wall.
That's right.
Real quick, because you said that, and I would have had it prepared had I thought about it, but there's something going around on social media that is so worth everybody checking out. I'll get it in a second, but there's a radio station, and I've stayed up mostly all night, a few nights listening to it. I want to say it's like Garden FM or Garden Radio. I'll check it in a second. But it's this giant map that you click on, and there's dots all over the world. And at moment, you click the dot, and it goes into that local radio station. Dublin, Kazakhstan, you know, parts of England, anywhere. My favorite is the, I don't know if it's Manitoba. It's this like French Canadian, like super like country western station.
Zoo.
Yeah. No, but it's all if you're not listening to the lyrics, like, oh, it's country music, but it's all in French. It's all in French Canadian. There's anything you've ever wanted to hear around the world, and I'll find it in 1 second. It's really fun.
I'm picturing me when I was on terrestrial radio and somebody like clicking on to me going, what's up with the left turn arrows? And then 4 years later, they click back. It's like, what these arrows? This fucking left turn. Why are they turning red? And then come back.
They must be re-airing the episode.
Guy in Turkey thinks this is the biggest problem in LA.
What was that station, oh, here it is. Max Zapata?
I'm guessing, and I doubt this is right, but Star 98.7.
No.
Played him. Okay.
No. You couldn't figure it out, like, who played Hootie. It would have to be sort of like L.A. 90s stations.
Because that was all brand new music.
Hootie's not going to define it, but like the Jayhawks would. And like Blues Traveler. I mean, that shit was revolutionary in the early, yes, mid-90s. Like, who are these guys?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Just so you know, this is called Radio Garden. Mm-hmm. And you can either click the link, or what's actually easier is downloading the app. And it's, I mean, you will waste hours, but it's not a waste. It's really cool.
Yeah, I like that.
Okay, so Mr. Potato Head, if you have one, or Mrs. Potato Head, you better hold on to them. You're not going to be able to get them for very long. Classic Hasbro toy, 70 years old at this point. They will soon be rebranded with the gender neutral Potato Head moniker. There will be no Mr. or Mrs. The new name will be reflected on packaging scheduled to debut later this year. Hasbro reportedly claimed that Mr. Potato Head, who's often seen alongside his lady friend, Mrs. Potato Head, needed a modern makeover. A spokesperson for the toy said, quote, "Culture has evolved and that kids want to be able to represent their own experience. The way the brand currently exists with Mr. and Mrs. is limiting when it comes to both gender identity and family structure."
Now, you know, sometimes we talk about this and we go, well, this is insane. And then they go, wait a minute, is this just kind of a ruse? Or are they going, oh, God, what was the talk show host that drew the swastika on his forehead in the bathroom? Morton Downey Jr.
Oh, my God.
You don't know that story?
I mean, I remember watching it when I was really little, but I don't know if I remember that.
Morton Downey Jr. was great. First off, anyone who smoked on TV was a hero of mine growing up. I know I speak for Dawson as well. He was like one of those TV smokers. He literally went into the bathroom in San Francisco Airport or something, roughed himself up. Like any guy who does that thing where they like punch yourself in your face, you know?
Right.
And pull, Jim Carrey, liar, liar.
Right, yeah.
Pull your tie and buff it and took a Sharpie. I think he took a ballpoint pen and drew a swastika on his head. And then he was like, I was attacked by neo-Nazis. It's kind of funny. It was like way before the Jussie Smollett stuff and whatever other sort of hoax race crimes are going on these days. He was a pioneer in this. And so I always wonder, like, is Hasbro going, we sold 9 units of Mr. Potato Head last year.
Yeah,
this thing is fucking dying on the vine. Why don't we pretend, you know, we'll put it out there and then hopefully, you know, Sean Hannity will get hold of it. And he'll go, right. Mr.
Potato
Head. Yeah, they've got to. First, it's the Disney cartoons. And now it's Mr. Potato Head. I actually did have a guy tell me today they're going after Grease now, the musical.
Why?
Nobody touches my beloved Grease. What's the problem? The Pink Ladies?
Also, Brian, do you even have to say why anymore?
I'm sure there's a reason.
Because it existed before. The new answer for why is because it's been here before now. That's the new thing. But they normalize rape or something. I don't know.
They're fighting off Kinnicky or whatever.
There's one line in Summer Nights that's a little hinky. But you know what? That doesn't mean we have to get rid of the T-Birds and the Pink Ladies altogether.
There's good. The story's out there because I was talking to Matt DeAndrea today and he's like, they're going after Grease now. I'm like,
nobody goes after Grease.
Can you change that line?
So
I was thinking out of it, but if the Mr. Potato Head news means it's either a great day for you or a horrible day for you, you need to really reevaluate. Like, if you're like,
right,
yes, we finally got them to change the Mr. Or how dare they change the Mr. If you're on either side, if it affects your day, if you have a strong opinion, this is, you need to reevaluate.
I completely concur. And I feel like these things are self-imposed to try to get their name. I mean, we're talking about it, right? A lot of Twitter users are saying Grease is rapey. So maybe that's the new, maybe that'll be the next one. All right.
Also lack of diversity.
I'm sorry.
Lack of diversity. Oh,
that's
yeah.
That's true, because it's all white kids.
That is true.
Somebody wrote, not only is it rapey, but it's just a terrible film. Now we have a problem.
I don't like Gina.
I don't like Grease. I don't like Grease at all.
Oh, Tessa's going to get into it.
She probably will.
She'll
be able to sing Summer Nights word for word.
It might be a lovely stage production. The movie kind of sucks.
Who
made their debut? They debut in Grease, I'm pretty sure. Michael Biehn.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. We talked about that. Didn't we talk about that with him?
I may have brought it up.
Yeah, of course.
It's kind of a young girl rite of passage to sit down and watch Grease.
It's a young girl rite of passage to assume that a 37-year-old Stockard Channing is a 16-year-old high school student.
Yes.
And, or however the whole how old she was in that movie.
All right, let's bring it home, Gina Grad.
You got it.
I got the updated on the radio station.
Okay, I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news. Gina
Grad! That was the news with Gina Grad.
What do you got?
Adam, there was a radio station that fit the format. AAA fits what you're talking about. Was it 101.9 KSCA? It was from 94 to 97.
Probably.
That would be it.
Probably it. Yeah, when I was hearing those songs that I still love today because Victoria Williams they were playing like John Hyatt and Graham Parker and stuff like that.
The artists include Sheryl Crow, Jewel, Sarah McLachlan, Wallflower, Suzanne Vega, Sean Colvin, David Matthews Band.
Yeah, those kind of bands.
Sounds like.
Yeah,
and
that's
Adam,
what it was.
You mentioned the Spin Doctors. Do you have the balls to admit that Two Princes is a good song?
It's a great song.
I like that song, and I like...
It's great.
I'll take Little Miss Can't Be Wrong.
Yes! Oh, two classics.
Oh, and they play Dr. Demento in the afternoons?
Oh, it's your station.
We got to resurrect those guys. All right, we brought it home. All right, let me tell you about GEICO. Do you own, do you rent your home? Well, you do one or the other. How about you make it easy and bundle up with your automotive plan? So GEICO makes it easy to bundle your homeowners and renters insurance along with your auto policy. Good thing, because you got so much to do already. So go to geico.com, get a quote, see just how much you could save when you go to geico.com and get your bundle on at geico.com. All right, maybe a few tickets left for Oklahoma City Bricktown Comedy Club, although I do not know. So go ahead and give it a try. We'll be out there. We'll do the pod live. We'll have Kyle Dunnigan on, always a treat, and then stand up. After that as well, then Reno, then Los Angeles, then Waukegan, Illinois. Just go to AdamCarolla.com for all the info you need. Tiller Russell, Silk Road. Go enjoy that. It's available now in digital and video on demand. Until next time, it's Adam Carolla for Gina Grad, Ball Bryan, and Tiller Russell saying, mahalo.